Hopefully your trip today wasn't so problematic as mine. Fortunately, we are here today. And today I will talk also about journey which will be led by fear and control. Our fear and our need for control in such dynamic environment as ours in software development, change is something obvious. That's why TestDouble came with help for us. They give us control, power over everything. And with such huge control, with such huge power, we can do everything. Everything we are expecting can become reality. It doesn't matter, is it true? Is it even possible on our production environment? Doesn't matter. It will become true. It will become true in our test. TestDouble is all about behavior. And this word is extremely important because many people forget about the one important thing in TestDouble. We are using them to mock, fake, pretend some kind of behavior that we are expecting. But I told them that everything what we can imagine can become true, can become our reality. We always need to remember that this is all assumptions. It can even not be true on our production environment. It can be only in our head. So this is important to remember that all this control, this power that we've got because of the usage of TestDouble, this is only in our head. And only proper usage of TestDouble lead to valid tests, to tests that will be useful for us. Before we will start talking about our journey, let me remind you what kind of types of TestDouble that we are using. Probably all of you know mock because of mock annotation in JUnit, and I believe that many of you, at least I do it, use annotation mock to create doubles, stubs, spies, and whatever any other types of TestDouble. Yet there are a few more. First is dummy. This is the most simplistic one. We are using it whenever we don't care about any interaction. We've got class, which is block. We can write articles, create new one, and we can get information about number of written articles on our blog. Adding articles is for the sake of the example, we can assume that we are adding articles to the list. Here, we are retrieving size of the list. So to test whether number of articles methods returns correct and valid result, we don't care what our article is. We don't care about content. We don't care about author. We don't care about anything. We care only about its presence. This is our dummy object. Another way it's just create mock with nothing mocked. So we are adding two articles and we are verifying whether two articles are present. That's also why dummy object is not always treated as test dummy. Why? There is no behavior in it. This is about presence. This is about its existence. Another, it's fake object. We can there is example class, event processor. It have something like store. This class is used to store events. And whenever we are invoking process all method, we are retrieving all stored events from our store, and we are processing each. To test it, we can use fake object. What is fake object? This is the simplistic implementation that fulfill our assumptions over the object. In our case, what we want to fake, this is our store. We need two methods. First, which will get information. We don't care whether it will be stored in database, in memory, in CSV document, whatever. It only needs to store it somewhere. The most simple implementation, in my opinion, would be based on list. So we adding element to the list, and we are returning all events. How we are using it? This part is our assumptions. So we are creating events. We are putting them into our store. This is our fake. And after processing all, we are expecting that our store will return both of them, event one and event two. So how we can test it? We are checking whether method process of event one and event two was invoked. It's here. Store, whenever we will return all of them, it will result with processing each. Another is stub object. This is the same test, as you can see. A little bit simple, because we don't have all this fake object implementation. We are just writing down what we want to stub. So whenever we are invoke method get all, we return as list our both events. So what is stub? Stub returns always the same value. We don't care about input. We only care about output. As you can see, no input parameters. We don't do any calculation on it. We don't expect anything. Only what we care is return particular value. Of course, there is one more thing worth to mention. Here, there could be method with parameters, but stub assumes that we don't care about a parameter. So if our input could be any object of particular type, that would be also stub. If we should depend on input, that will be later, soon. Okay, next is spy object. Spy, as name says, is all about spying. So we are in the example we got publisher. It's changing state of the article into published after article will be published. So what we want to spy, that method published was invoked. We don't care what will happen later. We don't care about input, output. We care that this method was invoked, whether we will execute method process of our class. So it's right here. We can use annotation. This is from JUnit Mockito. So spy, this is our spy. And we are just checking like that. Verify that the article was published. And the most powerful is mock object. Mock object cares about both, about our input and our output. We can also, in the same moment, we can verify whether input was exactly as we want. In example, published article. If it will be draft, then we don't care. We leave it. We will our test will fail. Here, this is the part. We got our predicate. Firstly, let's start with method that we want to test. This is our event processor that was mentioned here. We will add one more method. It will publish. It will process all events, depends on predicate. If predicate will be satisfied, we will process the event. This is our mock. As you can see, we care about input. If it will be event one, then it won't be satisfied. It will be satisfied. If event two, it won't be satisfied. Then we are checking whether event one was processed. This is what we expect. If it will be satisfied, then we will process it. And event two won't be satisfied, it won't be processed as expected. So as you can see, mock is the most powerful. Sometimes it's called that it's mix of stub and spy, because firstly we are spying this part. We are expecting that method will be invoked with proper parameters, and then we are returning the value based on those parameters. So those were our types of test dummies. It's important to know when and how use them in particular situation. It's good to use the dummy wherever you are. You want to use dummy. It's good to name those objects dummy, spy, stub. Why not? Your test should be descriptive. So don't hide that this is spy object if it's spy object. The most common pitfalls of using test doubles whenever we let ourselves to be lead guide by usage of test double, whenever we start using them almost automatically. We are just writing test, using test doubles almost without brain. Without brain, with more automatication, it results with more test doubles. And what are the test doubles? Those are assumptions. The more assumptions, the more fragile our tests became. They are no longer proper documentation of our code because we are assuming about everything. We cannot say that this particular code will work on production like that. No, we can say that this particular code will work like that if this will happen, this will happen, this will happen, and also this one. So remember, minimize the amount of test doubles because those are all assumptions. We are often thinking that whenever we are starting using test doubles, that unit tests are okay. They are okay, but not if they are only type of test that we've got. Unit test should test unit, but application, our product, is not only unit. Probably, I believe this in most of your cases and mine, it's huge, complex product. We need integration test, we need component test, we need system test. All of those types are needed, and unit test should help you to introduce new changes, to expand your product, should let you to refactor without fear. Later I will show that this refactoring with too big amount of test double isn't so fearless as we want to. Unreal situation. As I mentioned, test doubles, assumptions, more happens in our head rather than in code on production level. So there is a chance that we imagine more that real can happen. We will test not for sake of be safety. We will test for the coverage because we want to have high. I assume that. Okay, no assumption. Whoever saw a code, test of the code, and after first look, you knew that you won't know nothing from those tests. Okay, I'm the first guy. There were plenty. Happy for you. It's really good to know that your tests are descriptive and can be used as documentation. Unfortunately, in my case, there were many situations that I look at the code. Oh, Jesus Christ, what's going in here? Okay, fine, 100% of coverage. I will go to the to our test. I'm opening the test. Okay, I'm enough. I will get back to the code. I will read it because those tests are useless for me. And one of the reasons are unreal situation because we sometimes testing too much. Test only what should be tested, only what you care, only what you think that can be broken. Another thing, aggregation over composition. Important thing, not composition in manner of using interface, but composition like using classes built from a few parts, and even if those parts are strict part of the whole, we are using injections. Why? Because it's easier to mock injections. We are not creating objects anymore inside the object, even if this object is they par- they the structure that, that is responsible for them, for their creation. We are creating factories, we are creating builders, we are using the dependency injection, and with our great framework like Spring, we even abusing it because we don't care at all. It's so easy to inject object that we always everything pass with either in constructor or through setters. And that leads for to fourth. Whenever we are see dependency in dependency, we are using test doubles. Why? Because it's easy. If you know how to do it, why not? It's easy to say that this object will return on invocation this particular method what I want. It's simpler than create this object. And maybe creation of this object will be hard. And if it will be hard, maybe something is wrong in with my design. Okay, maybe I will create too many objects. Maybe creation of those objects will be too complex. Then I should think about those objects. Then I should rethink my design. Maybe do some refactoring before I will add additional functionality. What for thinking is hard. So drop it, let's use mocks. It will be easier, just like that. More mocks, more fragile code. This is what I said before. Mocks equals assumptions. More assumptions, less real our code is. That leads us to more fragile code. And if the code is really fragile, then our refactoring or introducing new changes became really hard and really problematic. We start to fear refactor, touch our code. And this is something really weird because if you read Kent Beck book TDD by examples, he said that unit tests should be written, what for? To let us refactor our code without fear. Because we knew that whenever we will change something, our test will tell us just after first change. With mocks, it not always happen. Mocks, returns mocks, etc. Maybe you saw getters chain in your code. It's like, it will be in a moment. So I will get back to this. How to make our life easier? How to protect ourselves from mock abusing? Firstly, say no to accessors. Okay, I'm not too fanatic, so don't get me wrong. It's not don't use getter setters at all. No, you use them if it's really useful, but not introduce them only because it's easier to get particular information from object. Okay, so I will add get. Think. Because one more additional thing, whenever you are mocking, stabbing, spying getter, remind that test doubles should be about behavior. So if we are checking getter are not about behavior. Getters, setters are about implementation. So maybe there is something wrong in here. There should be no additional behavior in mocks. You saw how powerful mocks are in here. We can say what input we are expecting and what output we will return. Let's assume that it is possible to put expectation in here. I'm always talking about test. So we will expect some input. We will do various calculations on it to return particular result. We can do that, but we shouldn't. Why? Because this is additional behavior. Our assumptions should based on our code. This is our code. If we will merge those two methods into one, and after we will get event, we will check whether this condition is true or not, and we will return the value, then accept the code that we are testing. In our test, we've got also code that we written. Whole functionality behind the mocks. We should avoid it. We should avoid any calculation in our test whenever you are writing mock, and even when you are don't using mock. We should expect the value. You know what you want to get. You know what your object should get. You know what you want to check, and you know how your object will behave. There is no magic in it. Should be no magic in it. No logic in constructors. Why? Because it's hard to test. A few minutes ago, I said that we are using composition over aggregation. Right now, no additional logic in constructor. It's okay to create parts of the object in constructor. If they are strictly related with this object, fair enough. But there should be no additional validation, no additional calculation, and so on and so on. We've got patterns for it. It's easier to test whether factory will return valid object than create this object and listen for exceptions. And on the other hand, what about responsibility of the object? It will be both creation, valid creation, and second, the functionality which will provide after this creation will be done. One more thing, don't use mocks if it's easy to create object. Creating mocks costs you something. It's hard to, it's expensive. And if you got one object with one value, and based on this value, it returns in the its methods something, just create it. It will be easier. And one more thing, your code will be less fragile. Mocks are assumptions. When you are using real objects, then you are using real object. If you can create this object, if it's allowed, then there are huge chances that it can really happen. It increases your trust in those tests. It increases value as a documentation of those tests. It's increased readability because there is no additional magic. What those mocks means? What those give and then verify? What's that? You don't care. You are not using it. You are using real object. So everyone who came to this code will read it and will understand it. You can use parameter object. This is nice example. We've got method with three parameters, and we are invoking methods of those parameters. Don't care about logic. As you can see, there is none. In test, building the environment prerequisite for our test, it's like this. We need to create three objects, which are here, and we need to create three additional objects to store them. In that case, maybe it's worth to introduce parameter object. Just take those three objects, get rid of those, or map those three objects into context of the method. What happened in here? When you are looking at the methods inside in the code, no logic changes. Our code will still look as, work as it worked before. But what happens, except new class? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We've got 6 dependencies in here. Only 4 in here. Our code is less fragile because there is less dependency. It's good direction. There is no need for new about all those bar, bus, y, x, y, x, y, z. There is no need for this knowledge because this method doesn't care about it. This is interest. And this is how we can deliver it. Law of the matter says that you shouldn't do chains like this. Why? If you look right here, person get age, this is our adult predicate. We are verifying that whether particular person is adult or not. Person get age, get years, is it enough or not? Fair enough, it will work. But what happens in here? This is hidden dependency. No one will knew about this when he will or she will use the code. It must you must get into this code. You must look at this particular line to see there is dependency in here. Why? What for? Not needed. Person knows its age, so maybe person can give us information about the years. This is our preparation, 6 lines of code. When we will change it into person get years, only 3. Maybe still not perfect, but I believe that this part of code is more readable. And nothing hidden, everything is known. We can go even farther with that. Tell, don't ask. Person should know whether it's he or she is adult or not. So just ask. Person have got all data inside. Don't try to retrieve this data. You don't care about structure. You don't care about implementation. You care what he or she can do. He can go with me drink. Okay, it's fine for me. I don't care whether he's adult here when he's 18 years old or more. I don't care about the age. I care only about this. But it's also worth to mention that sometimes when we need more params to do those calculations, it won't be possible to tell, to ask for the result because there will be need more information. But when we are backing to our examples, let's look at our test. We start with something like this. 5 lines of code, we end up with 2. Simple. When we are using test doubles, we are often forget about the one simple word that I mentioned in the beginning. It's all about behavior. You are interested in interaction. What happens if this object will speak to this one? You don't care. Okay, what it happened underneath? You don't care about data. You care only about behavior, relations, and that you should focus on. Whenever you want to use these doubles to mock fake structure, think about it, because test, your pure test. Should be about tested functionality. If so, you shouldn't retrieve information from you should get out those information to the outer world. Implementation is leaking when you are using getters in your test. what you are assuming how it will behave. You don't care about attributes. You only care about dependencies, interaction. And if you are start using test doubles to fake your structure, to not use proper classes but dependency, refactoring and change became problematic. I can use string concatenation to return a string. I can use string buffer, string builder. And if you are interested whether my printl will return hello world, you are okay. You are checking whether it's hello world or not. But if in your test accept this string hello world, you will also check what kind of classes I used to build this string, how I did it, then even if I want to only do something with our performance, I need to change my test. Why? The result will be still the same. Whole expectations around the class will be still the same. But the way how I will implement the code will change. So I need to change the test. And what about safety? What about safety refactoring? There is no longer this term. And the same came with changes. When everything is written strictly in your test, each redesign, introducing, extracting the code, introducing strategy, will lead you to changing your tests. It shouldn't be like that. There should be possibility to change the code, redesign your code on particular level, refactor it, run the test, and test should tell you, are we still fine or not? Yeah, and this refers to the first one. Implementation is leaking. Reader, person who read our documentation, because this is our tests are documentation of our code. So whenever developer will read our code, there will be mix of responsibilities, because first he will get knowledge what this code should do and how it should work. And second, he get information how it does it. And this is not what he is interested. When I'm reading documentation of app on my mobile phone, I don't care whether it's Python, Java, how they are handling events and so on. I'm interested what this application give me. When you are reading your test or other developers' test, you're also interested in the code. What this code will do for you, how it will behave in particular conditions. Great topic about code extraction and test doubles. Let's assume that we've got our okay. Let's assume that we've got class, and after a while, this class is responsible for validation of input from our form. On the day one, we've got two fields. So we are putting everything into one class, and it's fine for us. On day two, we're adding third field. And we are pretty okay with that. Fine for us, we are putting additional logic into our code, and we are adding tests. But after some time, there are more fields. And we notice that some of those fields have similar functionality. So we decide to extract the code, create new class. We've got form validator, we create field validator. We are putting the code outside. It's still in the same scope, one package. Our we've got only one public class, which is our form validator. We are putting everything behind. What we should do? Should we mock used class or not? We started with this one single class. More code, more tests, and after some time we decide to split the responsibility. One class is responsible only for managing all of those complex fields pool, and second are responsible for particular fields. If we are strict to the rule that we should refactor the code without touching the tests, we should leave that. We should leave our tests. Okay. What about classes being underneath, tested or not? In my opinion, it's okay to leave top-level tests if we are testing only public method of the package. If everything is under the class, it's hidden, it's okay to use still test only this test. It's only important to know that your naming convention will change. It won't be unit test no longer. It would be component test. But that's all. You don't care how our form validator creates all those validators and how it's do it, whether it's 3 or 5 classes. No, you were on the day one interested with overall result, and nothing changed. There are only new features. And what if there are few of form validator like this? And we notice that in 3, 4, 5 classes, we are using the same types of field validators. We are moving them into another package. They became public. We can somehow use them. Should we still have one test or not? My suggestion is, if you start with one test, let's leave it. It's okay to have still one particular test. It's just important to remember to don't name it if some purist will came to you. This is not unit test no longer. This is component test. But you are not interested in one field. On package level, okay, there will be unit test. But to be honest, the most important thing for you is the complex whole. And if we decide to extract interface, and this is something different. This changes the rule of the games. Whenever we are extracting the class, we are basing off the particular implementation. We know how it will be implemented. When we are extracting interface, it's no longer about a particular implementation. We are interested in behavior. Whenever we are extracting interface, we assume that there can be more implementation of this interface to provide satisfied effect that will satisfy us. In that case, in my opinion, it's good to start using mocks. Another good example is boundary object. Let's assume that we've got our class that's publishing our reports. We are using some external class from different library. We just include it and we are using it. We know that it's fine. And we are creating something like this. This is our external reporting service. It's used right here. And this usage of boundary object says that each external class should be wrapped. Why? It's simpler when I will show like this. Let's assume that our external library provider will decide that there will be additional parameter priority in his publish method, and he don't care about backward compatibility. He will just change it. From one side, we want to update because there were some safety features, performance features, whatever. We want to. But we are using this external reporting service in many places. What we will do? We need to change our code base, first thing. We need to change our test, second thing. If we are if we will wrap the object into something like this, we've got this publish method, we can decide what we will do with this additional parameter. In that case, it can be different change, method renaming, and so on. This change, whatever will happen in this class, it's here. It will stay here. To be honest, if there will be more methods in here, we can use even something different. Maybe for one method we will use older version, maybe for a different method we will use newer version. Maybe we will change our external reporting service into something different. We don't care. This is our test, this is our class, and we are using it. We are the owner of it. We decide what interface will be. That's why wrapper is your friend, and you should mock objects that you are the owner. Why? Because it will came any change will come from you. There will be no any external developer, external library provider who will tell you you need to change it. You will need to change it, of course, if you are using, but there will be only one place. Only one place, it will be covered by integrational test, because you need to test whether this reporting external reporting service works or not. You will check it, but if something will fail, you will get fast feedback, and then you can fix it in one place. In my company, when we talked about boundary objects, there was a great question, what about the JDK? Because there is a lot of classes, functionality that we've got without any external effort, any additional effort. And it's hard to tell, because from one side, creators are so friendly for us that they are sticking with backward compatibility, so it's almost always possible to move forward. But if you want to be really safe, also, if it's functionality, just wrap it. If it's structure, you can back to this part, dependent class. But if it's functionality, if you depend on some kind of behavior, it's always better to wrap this. So this is the main question. Where test doubles lead us? To the place where we've got too many test doubles. This is not the place where we want to be. It's obvious that in the so changeable workplace as ours, we want to have control over something. We want to be certain. At least one thing, test doubles give us this exactly what we want. We will control everything. But in our world, we need to know how to change, how to adapt very quickly. So don't abuse test doubles, because it will lead you to the place where you will fear of the change. This is not the place where you want to be. You want to be agile, whether you are using the methodology or not, doesn't care. something will change. Nothing ever will become the same as it was on the beginning. So you need to know how to change. You need to know how to adapt, and your test needs to support you with that. It must help you. So whenever you are looking at the code of the test, and you cannot read it, you stop understanding it. Stop for the moment. Do refactoring. Think what can be changed. Think what can be improved. If you are not sure whether the code is readable or not, okay, I wrote it. It's fine. I understand it. Give it to someone. We've got code reviews. Someone should check it. If he or she will understand it, you can assume that your documentation is okay. It's not too complex. The presentation was about warning signs, law of the matter, abusing of solid principles, especially a single responsibility principle, using dependency injection everywhere, using gathered heavily. Those are warning signs. Those aren't strict rules, but it's good to look whenever you are see code like notice code like this, and ask yourself: is it okay? I've done it for purpose, or this is only my laziness? Okay, so go improve your tests. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the lecture.